Hi everyone, I hope you're having a good week and it's my pleasure to get with you for our Wednesday night time. In just a minute, we will be back in 1 Corinthians. We'll be in chapter 1, verses 17 to 25 as we continue to walk through it together. And I'm looking forward to that. Just a couple of announcements before we do so. First thing is that we have scheduled a business meeting. That's going to be on Wednesday, November 1st. So mark that on your calendar. I will be announcing that on Sunday mornings, obviously, for the next couple of weeks. And then secondly, if you check your bulletin, you can see the information about sending care packages for our college students. We want to bless them as Christmas is coming up, just to let them know that we're thinking about them, praying for them, and that we love them and finding tangible ways to do that. And then also, we will be meeting this Sunday evening at 6 o'clock p.m. for our whatever we're calling this right now, just at the church building in the auditorium. Probably be watching a couple videos, singing together, giving testimonies, praying together. So be planning on that. It's a good opportunity, maybe even to invite someone who's not participated in that. Okay, I also want to, before we do the study, continue to show you this video of this song that we will be learning in the next weeks together. It is called Loving Kindness by Matt Papa and Matt Boswell, and hope it's a blessing to you. Familiarize yourself with it. You can even sing along with the video. So here it is.
We'll greet your mercy with a song. Your people stand and sing for all your loving kindness. You've carried us in faithfulness upon the paths of righteousness. Our gracious King, you've crowned us with your loving kindness. How great is your love! With arms outstretched upon the cross, the greatest gift there ever was of loving kindness. The grave could not defeat our King, who rose in victory now to reign, so we could live and ever sing of loving kindness. Such loving kindness. Sing the glad refrain
All right. I hope that is a blessing to you. As we've mentioned before, we'll continue to learn that in the next weeks and be blessed by it. I'm thankful that God has given us traditional hymns in history that were written by people who cared about good theology, the supremacy of Christ. And I'm thankful that God has given us those who are doing that now. Okay, so let's jump into the study. We are in 1 Corinthians 1, 17 through 25, as Paul moves on from the divisiveness that is in the church because people are aligning with certain preachers. The message of the cross is seen by some as foolish, but by others as powerful and wise. And here's where it kind of fits in the outline. We are in divisions over Christian preachers. The problem was reported in the previous section. And here, all the way to chapter 4, verse 21, God's wisdom answers the problem. First of all, where we are tonight, the message of the cross is true wisdom and power in contrast to the world's perspective. Then, and this directly relates to people boasting in the preacher they aligned with, God chose this way to be made right with him so that human boasting is excluded. And so getting that will contribute to a humility, which will lead to love and unity in the church. So here is something that I read in some of my material that I'm using for preparation. In 1 Corinthians 1, 17 through 4, 21, Paul exhorts the Corinthians to get back to true Christian unity by embracing Christ crucified as the solution to their quarreling and competitiveness, because Christ crucified is the basis of all spiritual life. That's all the way to chapter 4, verse 21. This larger section can be broken down into the nature of God's wisdom. That's all the way to chapter 2, verse 16, including what we're looking at tonight. And then in the next weeks, God's wisdom applied to the human preachers and the Corinthians themselves. The verses in these next two studies, chapter 17, or chapter 1, verses 17 through 31, through verse 25 tonight, and then through verse 31 next week, deal with how the message of the cross is true wisdom and power. And God chose this to eliminate human boasting. We simply proclaim what God has done in Christ and trust that he will use that message to change people. Right? Here are the verses. So let's look at them together. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. All right, those are the verses. Look, as we always do, at some general questions. What are your initial observations, thoughts, or questions about the whole passage, or any specific words, phrases, or thoughts? As always, maybe a good time to pause this, go back and look at the verses, and see how God would lead you maybe to make some observations or have some questions. And then letter B, how would you briefly describe the passage? Here's what I have. The message of the cross is foolishness to the unregenerate, but to those whom God calls, it is understood and embraced as the power and wisdom of God to save. Okay, so let's look at the specific verses. Letter A, what is Paul's emphasis as he transitions in verse 17 from discussing aligning with certain preachers to the seeming foolishness but actual power of the message of the cross? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. Paul's stressing that God didn't call him to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And it is not to be marked by the world's perspective of rhetorical eloquence. That doesn't mean that we can't have good communicators preaching the gospel, but at its basis, its power is not in rhetorical eloquence or the skill of the speaker. Its power is in Christ and the cross itself. so that what is seen to truly have wisdom and power is the message of the cross of Christ, the gospel. Letter B, verses 18 to 25. And so there under letter B, I have kind of this summary, and then we'll have a 1 through 6 underneath that. Verses 18 to 25 can be summarized as the message of the cross is seen as foolishness by the unregenerate, but it is designed by God to be understood and embraced as wisdom and power by those whom God has called. So what do you see in verse 18 that emphasizes this? For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Paul simply says that the gospel, that's the word of the cross, cannot be grasped and is actually considered foolish by unregenerate people. And then I would add, especially in the context here, those who think they're wise. However, for believers, it is the opposite in every way. That's those who are being saved. It's not only seen as not foolish, but actually the height of power encompassing every grace of God. Okay, so let's discuss the reality of this. We can see this in observation, right? Personally, you've seen this. Until the necessary work by the Holy Spirit happens in regenerating those who are called, someone simply cannot embrace the wisdom and power of the gospel. No matter how smart they are, no matter how educated they are, no matter how eloquent they are in their speaking, how wise they think they are, they just simply cannot embrace it. There's obviously a spectrum of this lack of understanding. What I mean by that is that there would be some who like might intellectually say, yes, Jesus lived, he was divine, he did all of these things, but they still don't internally grasp it and are therefore not saved. And then the other end of the spectrum is those who would say that Jesus was not divine, that his, even if he died, you know, even if he was a human who died, it was certainly not in any way atoning. And that there's, and then you would have even on that end of the spectrum, atheists. But the fundamental basis is constant. It is the inability to grasp the wisdom and power of the gospel, the cross, Christ. However, when God has opened our hearts, those of us who believed, God has done that to our hearts in mercy. We can fully understand and treasure the gospel in God. And that is the dividing line. Those who are on one side who cannot understand it because God has not done that work in their heart, and those whom God has done the work in their heart, so they see the wisdom and power of it and embrace it and treasure Christ. And then the last question here, what is notable about the phrases are perishing and being saved? Those who are perishing have not experienced the Holy Spirit giving them understanding, so they don't believe and are on their way to hell. And you could maybe even subdivide this into two categories. Maybe there are some who are temporarily in that state and God is going to regenerate them in his sovereignty and wisdom, and only he knows that, but we preach the gospel to all. And so therefore there will be a time later in their lives where they're not perishing. But then there is a category of those who will never be regenerated, trust Christ, see the wisdom and power of the cross, and they indeed will spend eternity under God's wrath. Those who are being saved have experienced the realities of the gospel initially, right? That's regeneration, the call, justification, faith, all of those things, the new birth, but then continually, right? We are being saved, being made more like Jesus until one day God completes our salvation when he glorifies us, either when we die or when Jesus comes again. Okay, second question here under letter B. Whom or what is Paul describing in verses 19 and 20? Paul says, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Okay, it's any person or perspective in these verses that claims to be wise and considers the gospel foolish. So in Paul's day, it may have been philosophers, like even in Corinth, or intellectuals, or these very gifted speakers who spoke very, very long to show how persuasive they were in their speech. In our day, it encompasses any person or system that claims any sort of knowledge. So that could be those who say that science contradicts the Bible because they're atheists. Or it could be those who just consider anything about the Bible to be fairy tales. Okay, anyone like that. So they're actively against it. Or it could be someone passively considering the gospel to be nonsense. That would be the type of person who's just saying, well, I don't need what the Bible says, or I'm a good person. So there's a spectrum there too. But the commonality is that they are all against the necessity and wisdom and power of the cross of Christ. It can show itself in a variety of ways, from atheism, as I mentioned, to intellectualism, right? Those who say that anyone who's got any brains wouldn't believe in this nonsense or self-morality, right? I'm a good enough person. I don't have to be forgiven for my sins. And so therefore I don't need Christ. Okay. So there's a spectrum there too. It can show itself in a variety of ways. And the second question here, how and why does God make it foolish in verse 20? The quote, and that's from Isaiah 29, 14, and Paul's questions that are here in the verses, and then assertion that God makes foolish the wisdom of the world, demonstrate that all of this human wisdom, right, the one who's wise, the scribe, the debater of this age, is worthless. And it is those categories cannot process, ascertain, comprehend what has to be spiritually discerned. And in what God does, those are shown to be actually what is foolish. So it is a flipping upside down of what is really foolish and what is really wise. This may not always be fully discerned until the judgment. And what I mean by that is that there may be people who go on in their unbelief thinking that the gospel is foolish, and they will not be shown to be the ones who are foolish until God judges them in the last judgment and for eternity. But God will make all things right. Okay. And then I have except in believers, right? We obviously can discern that, but it is absolute. So whether you believe and know the wisdom and power of God in the gospel and Christ in the cross, or whether you reject it, think it's foolish because you think you're wise, ultimately, as Philippians 2 says, every knee will bow to Christ, and everyone will truly understand what is not foolish. The worldly human-generated wisdom will all be proven to be foolish. Number three, how does Paul refer to God's wisdom and people's wisdom in verse 21 to emphasize how God saves? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom. Okay, so God designed it this way, that any human wisdom in any of those categories can't is incapable of discerning spiritual things. It pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. So what is seen as foolish is actually what gets into people's hearts through the preaching of the gospel. The Holy Spirit uses that to regenerate hearts. Their minds then understand the glory of the cross. Okay? God has purposefully designed it so the human reasoning, intelligence, etc., can't discern the gospel. We see that in culture and in history. See it all around us. Those who think that they are wise are really the ones who are fools, because again, this is spiritually discerned. It is only in the seemingly foolish message of God, man, sin, and Christ that God brings sinners to himself. Faith comes through hearing, hearing through the word of Christ. That is inextricable from God's sovereign work. And that when the Holy Spirit brings about the new birth, regenerates someone's heart, the effectual call when God speaks into a person's heart so that they can see what they previously couldn't. Number four, in what way, in verses 22 and 23, does Paul say the gospel is absurd to both Jews and Greeks and Gentiles? For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. So Paul uses interchangeably the idea of Greeks. That's obviously those who are from Greece, but then Gentiles to talk about kind of everybody who's not a Jew. The idea of God saving through a crucified Messiah was offensive to an unbelieving Jew who demanded signs. We can see that even in the Gospels when they demanded signs from Jesus, and nonsense to an unbelieving Greek who valued human wisdom, right? We think of these Greeks and they're really holding to this idea of philosophy and wisdom. But God's power to bring people to him works through a deeper wisdom than humans can recognize. Unless God grants faith. And so it is important that we understand that for a person to discern these spiritual things about which we're talking, the saving power of God in Christ and the cross, God has to grant faith. The preeminence of Christ crucified and proclaiming that in its simplicity and fullness can't be overstated. And so that is how verse 23 provides the basis for what we proclaim. We preach Christ crucified. That doesn't mean we don't do it winsomely and with intelligence and skill and all those things, but the basis of that is not in any way in our skill. The power of it is in the cross and Christ. And that can't be overstated. All right, fifth question. What is the contrast in verses 24? It should be verses 24 and 25, I think. And what is the basis of how a person grasps this? for anyone, Jew or Gentile, when God sovereignly and effectively calls them, they are granted a new heart that can ascertain true wisdom, and they embrace Jesus as the power and wisdom of God to save. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. And so, as we take the whole Bible's message, those who are called, we go back to Romans chapter 8, Paul says that those whom God predestined, he called. Those whom he called, he justified, and those whom he justified, he glorified. So the call here is the effectual call that God does to those whom he's chosen before the foundation of the world. And that call works. There's a general call to all to believe the gospel, but that general call does not contain the power that the effectual call that God mercifully puts into someone's heart as they hear the gospel, and it secures their faith. Okay? So, for anyone, Jew or Gentile, when God sovereignly and effectively calls them, they're granted a new heart that can ascertain true wisdom. They embrace Jesus as the power and wisdom of God to save. Second question then, what does Paul mean by God's foolishness and weakness in verse 25? Paul's saying that the foolishness and weakness of God are not really that. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men. The weakness of God is stronger than men. The cross is what genuine wisdom and the cross is what is genuine wisdom and power. Though people naturally think the opposite. So what is seen to be foolish, what is seen to be weak, is actually what is wise and what is strong. Number six, from your own experience, how can you affirm what is being said here about how the message of the cross is indeed both powerful and wise? This is an opportunity for you to think through how you, because of God's effectual call in your life, because of the new birth, because God has been merciful to you, you now see and savor the wisdom and the power of God in Christ and the message of the cross in Christ crucified. And you know that you treasure it and you love it. And maybe for some of us, it's been a long, long time since that began in our lives, but we're treasuring Jesus more and more as he's making us more like him. And that is a wonderful thing. And the fact that you are able to ascertain that and discern these spiritual realities is merely because God has been merciful to you. So it causes us to worship. It causes us to treasure Christ more. It causes us to dive deeper into that wisdom and power, and it causes us to want to proclaim it because it is only the proclaiming that of that and then the Holy Spirit using that to provide the effectual call that saves anybody in the first place. Final thoughts and application. You have any final observations, comments, or questions? And then, letter B, how do you think you can apply the truths of this passage to your life? The humanly speaking, counterintuitive nature of the message of the cross of Christ is precious to us. It is how God saves those whom he calls, both objectively in what Jesus has done. Okay, and so the actual events of Jesus's life, death, and resurrection, that's the objective part. That's how God saves, but then subjectively and how he brings understanding to a heart. That's your experience when God indeed did do what God does to bring someone to the knowledge of Christ so that they will believe, right? When God did that to your heart, that's the subjective aspect of it. It's what everybody who's saved has experienced, but you can say personally, yes, I have experienced that. In response, we should treasure it, proclaim it, and live by its wisdom and power. Okay, that's it. So thank you, and I hope that it is a blessing to you. As we now move into our time of prayer, I won't take too much time to pray, but I wanted to mention a couple of announcements or prayer requests. First of all, I believe, as everyone knows, we want to be praying for all that's going on with the war in Israel and pray for God's grace to be shown in every aspect there. And then also, Ollie Hyatt's surgery is tomorrow. And this is a very serious surgery, I believe 18 hours long. So Diana has gone down to Seattle to be with Stephen and Allie and Ollie. So just be praying for that whole circumstance that God's grace would be very, very evident there. So those are the two that I really did want to mention. So let me lead everyone watching in prayer. Father, we come to you now and we are very, very grateful that you have indeed called us and that you have given us understanding so that we can see the wisdom and the power of the cross of Christ. And I pray that we would treasure that more and more, those of us who have been called and are being saved, as the verses say, that we would proclaim the cross of Christ, that that would be the basis for our obedience and worship and just our whole lives. And thank you for the power of it and what it really does. Thank you that we've all experienced that. We thank you just for every blessing that you give us and the fact that your grace is endless toward those whom you love. And we just rejoice in that. Thank you for our church family. I really love them and I'm very grateful for them. I pray that you will bless them in all of the things that are going on, physical things, job circumstances, family things, decisions, just the whole spectrum of ways that we still always need your moment by moment grace to sustain us and direct us and give us wisdom and power. So I pray for that. I pray that you'll help us to continue to grow as a church family in love for you and love for each other in discipleship and also in numbers. May we also be a light in our community and indeed proclaim Christ crucified. And I pray for all of the requests that are on our bulletin, but then especially these ones that I've mentioned. I pray for everything going on in Israel that you will demonstrate your sovereign grace there. And just thank you that as it's so heartbreaking to see all that's going on there, that we can trust you. And also I pray for Ollie Hyatt, and we just really just ask that your grace would be very, very evident as his surgery happens, that he'll come through that okay, that it will really, really help all of the situations with his heart valve and just everything going on there. And thank you that we can trust you in that too. I pray that you will sustain the family and that they will know your grace also. And then just pray for our local missionaries, our international missionaries, the things we have coming up in our church schedule and church family, that you will bless all of those things. Thank you most of all that Jesus has paid the penalty for our sins and that his righteousness is ours and that our penalty was his, that he's risen from the dead and we are dearly loved and we will never be separated from you and your love. And we rejoice in that. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, everybody. It's been a joy to be together with you, excuse me, this evening. And I look forward to seeing everyone on Sunday. Goodbye.